Coronary calcium, as many of you are aware, is really just the tip of the iceberg, and a slide made popular by John Rumberger showing us that atherosclerosis represents about 20% of the total plaque burden. Soft plaque, fibrous plaque, makes up 80% of plaque burden. So if we were only to detect or look for coronary calcium, we'd be missing a vast majority of events. The problem with that hypothesis, or in reality, what's happened is we found out that as we look at total plaque burden across a large spectrum of lesions in a given coronary tree, we're not looking at one calcified plaque in the LAD or one soft plaque in the right coronary, but we're looking at a total plaque burden in the coronary tree. And what we find is that about 20% of the plaque is calcified, but in a given person, rather than lesion by lesion. So as you see a patient with a lot of coronary calcium, they also have a lot of fibrotic plaque and lipid-rich plaque. The analogy is the Titanic. The Titanic goes downstream, sees ice floating in the surface of the water, doesn't send divers below to say, "I wonder if there's ice below the surface that can rip the hull." The same is true of coronary calcium. The presence of coronary calcium shows us that the overall plaque burden is high. And the larger the iceberg, the larger the overall plaque burden. So higher calcium scores reflect higher atherosclerotic burdens. And we have data going back to the Middle Ages that show us that hardening of the arteries is a bad thing. And they don't harden because of soft plaque. They harden because of calcified plaque. So coronary calcium will most likely give us a very simple look at who has plaque and who has some quantifiable amount of plaque, and therefore we can use it for risk stratification. So the recommended uses have focused around the idea of looking for those patients who are in this intermediate risk category, in this gray zone of the National Cholesterol Education Panel. Patients who don't have overtly high risk, who, yes, they absolutely need treatment, and overtly don't have very low risk, the worried well, who have no risk factors, as we just heard from Dr. Shah, the optimal risk patients, but those patients who are at risk for disease, who may benefit from further risk stratification. And the numbers that we have are remarkably consistent. There's at least a dozen studies now that show odds ratios, hazard ratios, or relative risks in the tenfold range. You are 10 times more likely to suffer a cardiac event with an elevated calcium score than with a lower calcium score or a zero calcium score. And the data is remarkably consistent from study to study. So I won't show you all the studies. I'm just going to pick a few that I think help highlight this idea that more plaque equals more risk, and no plaque, a score of zero, equals a very low-risk person. This is data from my lab, 25,000 patients followed for over a decade, long-term follow-up. We couldn't follow each patient independently and find out if they had myocardial infarctions and adjudicate each event. So we looked for all-cause mortality, but very simply, no coronary calcium. Patients were alive. These were patients at risk of coronary events referred by physicians for risk assessment. High coronary calcium scores, very high scores above 1,000. We saw about almost 30% of the population die. And the odds ratio for having a score above 100 was 10.4. You are 10 times more likely to die with an elevated calcium score as compared to those people with no or minimal calcification. So again, long-term data showing us that continued events occur over time. And while we talk about a 10-year risk as a kind of a standard, that lifetime risk is something that we're continuing to assess. And as we continue to follow this group, there's no doubt that these curves are going to continue to diverge as we move forward. Other data, large data sets that look at cardiovascular risk. This is the Cooper Clinic data. Again, no coronary calcium, very low cardiac risk. This is 10,800 patients, 3.5-year follow-up. And again, odds ratio of a calcium score above 100, 9.7. You're 10 times more likely to have a heart attack or die, hard cardiac event, with a score above 100 as compared to a lower score or a score of zero. Four other studies in different age and risk populations, the South Bay Heart Watch, higher risk population, older patients, mean age was 63 at entry, and you can see in black, higher scores, more cardiac events. This was 7-year follow-up. Dr. Taylor in the audience demonstrates in a lower risk population, the PAC study, mean age 43, that you can risk stratify with an odds ratio or hazard ratio of 11.8. So again, 12-fold higher risk in the presence of calcium in these populations. St. Francis Heart Study, 5,000 patients followed prospectively for 4.3 years, odds ratio 10.0. So you're 10 times more likely. And the Rotterdam Heart Study in the elderly cohort, their relative risk was only 7-fold. So the most disappointing, yet 7-fold represents 7 times greater than other factors. This is after multivariate analysis. In these studies, PAC, St. Francis, South Bay Heart Watch, and Rotterdam, C-reactive protein had no predictive power in multivariate analysis. So these worked, calcium worked in a multivariate analysis where, at least in these studies, these four studies, C-reactive protein failed to independently predict future cardiac events. What about looking at exercise testing? Looking at some form of risk stratification by looking at functional capacity. Very useful. If you look at the right, these diabetic patients, who asymptomatic diabetic patients who underwent nuclear tests and were followed for 3 years, and you can see no normal nuclear studies, much better survival, much better event-free survival than those patients with a 1-5% nuclear defect, and better yet, better again than those with a 5% or greater defect of on a nuclear scan. The relative risk was 12-fold, independently predicting that a nuclear scan in an asymptomatic diabetic predicted future cardiac events. The problem is that of those patients with a normal nuclear scan, 10% of them, 10%, suffered a myocardial infarction or died over the next 3 years. So, relatively still a high-risk group. A 10% event rate over 3 years is well over a 20% event rate over 10 years, making this group still, with a normal nuclear test, a high-risk group. So it didn't lower their cardiac risk. So we can't say that you had a normal nuclear test as a diabetic, you're no longer a high-risk patient. But if we look at the same cohort with coronary calcium, we can make that exact claim. Calcium score below 100, one patient out of 510 diabetics had an event with a score of 0 to 100 over the next 3 years. The annual event rate was much below 1%, and the 10-year event rate would have been estimated at much below 3% over those 10 years. So the overall event rate, very low, making a high-risk person, i.e. a diabetic, into a low-risk patient over the next at least short-term follow-up of 3 years. We need longer studies like this, but the odds ratio of a high score in a diabetic, a person who's already high risk, was 58. 58-1 increased risk of having events. The relative risk was 58-fold. So a huge increase in cardiac events with an elevated calcium score. So calcium score, at least in this population, had a better risk stratification than nuclear testing. And the reason, again, goes back to what we heard before. A negative nuclear test only tells us that they don't need angioplasty bypass surgery. Doesn't tell us that they don't have 30% stenoses that could plaque rupture and cause events. So a negative calcium score may give us better insight into plaque burden and therefore stenosis. Another study directly comparing coronary calcium scanning to exercise testing was a study that looked at calcium scanning versus stress echocardiography. And again, calcium scoring invoked about a 10-fold increased risk, score above 100 compared to a score below 100. And you can see 6-year follow-up here. Stress echo failed to show an independent association. The p-value was 0.17. So didn't quite hit statistical significance as an independent predictor of future cardiac events. So looking for functional abnormalities in an asymptomatic person may not be as robust as looking for plaque. And that probably just makes sense intrinsically, but now we have some data to look at this. This question will, I think, be answered definitively within the year when the Heinz-Nixdorf recall study comes out from Germany, where 4,800 patients underwent both calcium scores as well as treadmill tests. And we'll have prospective studies to look at the ability of functional testing compared to anatomical testing. But the NIH, the American College of Cardiology, and the American Heart Association, along with most payers, were waiting for the multi-ethnic study of atherosclerosis, an unbiased, independent study of 6,814 persons followed for the next now 7 years and planned on going out to 15 years. So we have long-term follow-up in a multi-ethnic cohort, and remarkably, the same numbers appear. A calcium score above 100 invoked a tenfold increased risk. So $62 million down, and we find out in this study exactly the same. Hazard ratio 10.3. Well, what has been shown before in the St. Francis Heart study, in a study by George Condos, back from retrospective data from Chicago, and all the other studies I've shown you tonight. So we have now definitive data that a score of zero imparted a very low event rate. The event rate was much less than 1% over 10 years when you calculate out an annual event rate under 0.1% per year. So a very low event rate for patients with scores of zero and a very high event rate for scores of 100 going up. As the plaque score goes up, the event rates go up. So the multi-ethnic study of atherosclerosis confirmed in men and women equally represented in Asians, African Americans, Caucasians, and Hispanics that coronary calcium is a robust independent predictor of future cardiac events. Now the patients in MESA did not only undergo calcium scoring. They had a panel of tests, including blood tests, including a lot of tests of inflammation, including carotid IMT. This paper came out in archives comparing the a predictive power of carotid IMT for future cardiac events to coronary calcium for future cardiac events. And you can see here CHD events. IMT was an independent predictor. Carotid IMT was an independent predictor of future cardiac events with an odds ratio of 2.1. A hazard ratio of 2.1. You are twice as likely to suffer an event if your IMT was in the top quartile. In the same group, they were 10 times more likely to suffer a cardiac event if their calcium score was elevated. And when you looked at a fully multivariate analysis, adjusted analysis, 2.1 dropped to 1.7, still statistically significant, and 10.3 dropped to 8.2. So even including the other test in the model, both carotid IMT and coronary calcium both predicted events independently, calcium was about five times more robust, at least in this one large study. So we'll await more data from other cohorts that have looked at both calcium scores and carotid IMT. But it appears that plaque in the heart predicts heart disease better than plaque in the carotids with at least the multi-ethnic study of atherosclerosis. We looked at, this is Karam Nasir's work. I know he's not here tonight, but he looked at another cohort of patients with multi-ethnic disease and found that across any different ethnic group, Asians, African Americans, or Hispanics, independent predictive power for different ethnic groups. The higher the calcium score, the more likely they are to die in this study. So it worked across multiple events. Now, going back to the original, the talk that we previously heard about Framingham risk and other risk factors, I think that there's a slight gap here that we need to recognize. Framingham score is great because it's free, because we can do it, because we all understand it. So there's a lot of advantages to the Framingham risk score. The problem is, you can argue it may be outdated, it was created in the 50s. It certainly doesn't encompass a multi-ethnic cohort because it was from Framingham, Massachusetts, which I think was a little under 99.9% white at the time. So it certainly doesn't have a multi-ethnic representation. And in this study done recently, the Framingham score had an area under the curve of 0.60. These were diabetics. The UKPDS score did better with an area under the curve of 0.74. But look at coronary calcium. The ability of coronary calcium to predict future cardiac events, area under the curve, 0.92. a very robust improvement over both Framingham or UKPDS, suggesting that we get both independent and incremental information from the calcium score that's going to add to our traditional risk scores. So I'm not suggesting that we replace the Framingham score, but that we use it in combination with a test like coronary calcium and help us identify, take those intermediate risk or low or high risk patients and re-stratify them better to predict events. Another study looking at the same thing, this time looking at a larger population. This is from Dr. Becker's work, published this year in AHJ, looking at 1,800 patients followed prospectively. And you can see here the Framingham score predicting events. You can see here the PROCAM score, which includes family history, the area under the curve, 0.63, the area under the curve, 0.65, the ESC score, the European score, 0.66, and the Agatston score increasing to 0.81. So again, robust improvement in risk prediction. This is now in a general group, not a diabetic population, where calcium scoring outperformed both ATP, PROCAM, and the European scoring system. So CRP has not been able to show this yet. We'll see the results of Jupiter tomorrow. Certainly doesn't validate or invalidate CRP, just showing us if we treat 15,000 patients, we can see event reduction. The randomization wasn't CRP or no CRP or low CRP, but again was rosuvastatin versus placebo. So a study of rosuvastatin, but we can look at the placebo event rate and see if it was elevated based on what we would have expected without CRP. So I think we'll get a lot of information about C-reactive protein from the Jupiter trial. So far, at least in MESA, CRP hasn't worked. The odds ratio right now is 1.0, so it hasn't independently predicted future events. In MESA, they're waiting for a longer follow-up to see if that improves before they report that it doesn't work. But so far, it has not predicted events independently in a multi-ethnic study of atherosclerosis, and we'll have to see if other data comes out to refute that. So where are we today? Well, 2001, the NCP said we could use coronary calcium for advanced risk assessment. A high score provides rationale for intensified LDL lowering. So that's good. If we get a calcium score, the higher the score, the lower the LDL. Makes sense. This goes back to 2001, predating every single study I showed you. So either Scott Grundy was forward-thinking or got lucky, but looks like the right answer to the right question. AHA in 2005 had more data to work with. So definitively said there was a recommendation to measure atherosclerotic burden in clinically selected intermediate-risk patients to refine risk prediction and select patients for altered levels of lipid-lowering targets. We take the people in the gray zone and we re-risk stratify them with a calcium score. A zero score, maybe less therapies. A higher score, more therapies. AHA in 2006 reiterated that, and it said that cardiac CT improves risk prediction, especially those at intermediate risk and for whom decisions concerning strategies may be altered based on the test results. A good adage for any test you're going to do. If it's not going to change your management, don't order the test. If it can change your management, then the test may be useful. The one place I want to really just finish up on is the problem we have in women. And I know that Dr. Falk already showed us some data on this, but women under the age of 70 almost universally cannot be, by definition, high risk. Unless they've already suffered an MI, they cannot be high risk by Framingham. So either we're going to continue to not treat women until they hit age 70. This is a study by Ford looking at Framingham risk stratified by age. No women hit high risk. 0% of women hit high risk under the age of 70. So obviously excluding diabetics who by definition are high risk, but with the exception of the diabetic female, no female would qualify for aggressive risk management. So we have to do something in this intermediate or maybe low intermediate risk population if we're going to change the way that we manage our patients. The same problem occurs in younger men, as evidenced by many studies, including Dr. Taylor's work in the PAC trial, showing us that these patients can be identified and predicted moving forward. So let me just finish up with the SHAPE algorithm, what you're familiar with, but I think important to recognize that when we take somebody and we start with, at least in a set population, we start with a test of atherosclerosis, whether it be coronary calcium or carotid IMT or other tests that may be forthcoming in the future, that if they don't have atherosclerosis, by definition, at least based on the available data so far, they're automatically lower risk patients. So they have a negative test. We would look for risk factors and still look to modify those risk factors, but probably in a much less aggressive algorithm than if we left them untreated. If we look at a positive test, patients with an elevated calcium score or an abnormal carotid IMT, we could stratify them into moderate risk with some calcium or abnormal IMT, into a high-risk group with a higher calcium score, or a very high-risk group with either a plaque on their carotid ultrasound or a very high calcium score, and lower their LDLs. Obviously, further testing, such as ischemic testing or angiography, would have to be left up to the referring doctor and based on the clinical scenario. But lower LDLs across a spectrum of increasing risk. So for the first time, we can match intensity of therapy to intensity of risk beyond what we can do with the current algorithm. So thank you very much, and I'll leave you with that idea.